Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, you talk about the foundational work we're doing.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Wow.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. On this lovely July Sunday, welcome to Seattle Vineyard Church. My name is John. This is my wife, Judith. We're the co-lead pastors, and we're going to begin our service with worship like we always do. So I'm going to hand it off to Jude as we get ready.
So we invite you to, as the Lord invites you to posture yourselves, to connect with Him, kneeling, standing, flags. We have candles there to remind us of the presence of God with us. So if you want to light the candle, we have a wall there where you can write your prayer requests. Just grateful that we can gather near and far to worship the one who is alive, the one who was and is to come. So, Lord, we are so grateful for your presence that's already here, and we ask, God, that we would be aware of your presence, that we would be coming to you with open hearts, welcoming your work in our lives this morning, Lord. We join the millions of people who are worshiping you across the earth. And we say glory to the one who was and is to come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Holy is your name in all the righteous are your ways, so merciful. Everything you've done is just and true. Holy, holy God are you. Holy, holy God.
All blessing.
All blessing. Everything you've done is just and true. Holy, holy God are you.
Holy,
holy is your name in all the earth. Righteous are your ways, so merciful. Everything you've done is just and true. Holy, holy God are you. Holy, holy God are you.
Holy are you, the sunshine. And you are warm like the sunshine on a bright summer day. You are clear as the blue sky when the clouds are rolled away. You are gentle as the evening breeze that blows against my face. And I love to be with you, beautiful God. I love to be with you, beautiful God.
You protect me. You protect me with your arms of love. Take away my fear. I'm reaching out my hands to you, 'cause I know that you are near. Lord, I whisper words of tenderness which only you can hear. And I love to be with you, beautiful God. I love to be with you, beautiful God.
As my love, as my love for you grows strong, close to you is where I long to be. As I gaze into your eyes, such a look of pure delight I see. Lord, you're smiling at me. You're warm. You are warm like the sunshine on a bright summer day. You are clear as the blue sky when the clouds are rolled away. You are gentle as the evening breeze that blows against my face. And I love to be with you, beautiful God. I love to be with you, beautiful God.
You protect. You protect me with your arms of love. Take away my fear. I'm reaching out my hands to you, 'cause I know that you are near. Lord, I'll whisper words of tenderness which only you can hear. And I love to be with you, beautiful God. I love to be with you, beautiful God.
That's my love.
As my love for you grows strong, close to you is where I long to be. As I gaze into your eyes, such a look of pure delight I see. now smiling at me.
Love to be with you, beautiful God.
I see you're smiling at me.
Love to be with you, beautiful God.
Oh, you're smiling at me.
Love to be with you, beautiful God.
Yeah, you're smiling at me.
I love to be with you, beautiful God.
We love to be. Oh, we love to be with you, beautiful God. We love to be with you, beautiful God. Yeah, we love to be with you, beautiful God. We love to be with you, beautiful God.
Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
Singing how lovely and oh, 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 love.
In praise, and it's you here.
worship you, God. Thank you, God, that you meet us where we are at, Lord. And you invite us, God, to lay our burdens down before you. The God who sees, who knows, who has great compassion. The one who can be trusted with every detail of our lives. Inviting you, me, us to surrender this morning. Let his loving arms wrap you, surround you. Let his mercy and his grace pour over you, over me, over us. Let his love hold us in the seasons that we're in sickness and in health, in death, in sorrow, in joy. You to speak out the goodness of God, the faithfulness of God, the patience of God. And if you don't have the words, He knows. Receive. Receive. The peace, the love, the comfort of God. He is here.
We're going to continue worshiping by taking communion together. So as soon as the elements are uncovered, thank you, Frank. Please come forward and take your elements back to your seats. And everyone online, please go ahead and get your elements ready. And we will take it together in just a moment.
Good morning. I had a little helper here, Theo, but he's been taken off to Sunday school, and Carrie Diaz is watching over him. Sweet. Yeah, please join us as we take communion together. On the night that he was betrayed. Oops. Jesus was eating with his disciples. When, while they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us eat together the bread. Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant." What a new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us drink together. Please pray with me. Oh God, one more time. What a privilege I hear on this side of eternity to share this with each other, with you. And thank you, God, for the new covenant that includes Gentiles. We are brought in and, you know, into your embrace with promises, and thank you for the security that we have in you, Jesus. Thank you for that we can be in Christ, in you, and you in us, both ways. Thank you this morning, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning again, everybody. Good morning and welcome to Seattle Vineyard. Thanks for being with us. And welcome if you came in during worship. Again, my name is John, along with my wife Judith. We are the co-lead pastors here at the Seattle Vineyard. And I'm going to highlight just a couple of the announcements that are in the program that you received when you came in. This coming week is our Vineyard Northwest Regional Conference. And if you're not attending, you can watch main sessions. There's a QR code in there. It's Wednesday night through Friday night. And the whole new national team, the leadership for our movement, will be there. If you're able to watch some of the main sessions, I really encourage you to. We are so pleased to have this new leadership team coming in. It's a wonderful, humble, talented group of people. We're very excited about all the things that God's going to do through the Vineyard movement in the coming years. There's something that I wanted to let everyone know about, the U District partnership, which I was blessed to be on the board for in the last few years. There's a new waterfront park down by the water, and to kind of celebrate it, they're doing these Friday night movies in the month of August, designed for families. They're all like water-themed movies, like Surf's Up and Moana, and it's family-friendly. I would love for us to be there, because it's going to be a chance for us to meet other families and residents of the U District. And it was one of those, like, goodness, why don't we go down there and see if we might meet some other people who live in the area? It's part of what we believe God is doing with us, learning how to minister to the people who live here. And so we're starting to let people know about that Friday nights in August, and it should be a lot of fun. And then one other thing, this is a new one also. There is a lecture on homelessness happening this week, Thursday, July 14th at 7, and it's hosted by the Church on the Ave, who we partner with to do Friday Feast every week, and we did our Ash Wednesday service with them this year. They're hosting an expert lecturer, Dr. Karen Snedker, SPU Professor of Sociology. And it's all about homelessness. It's going in depth about the issues that surround homelessness and homelessness here in our area. Something that we've been involved with as a church for a long time. So if you're able to attend that, should be very informative. So there's a few things there. Let's go ahead and take our offering. And once again, thank you. Thank you so much for supporting, for giving, for helping us do what we do here at the Seattle Vineyard. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for being so good. And out of your abundance, you give to us. You provide for our every need. And so we worship you, Father, by giving out of what you've given us. Because we trust you, not money, not bank accounts. We trust you, Father, for everything we have, everything we need. So use these resources, God, for the work of your kingdom through this church, we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and light my candle as I begin. This is a reminder to me of God's presence with me. And Father, I ask that you would give me grace. I ask, Holy Spirit, that you would breathe power on the words. I ask that you would speak to our own hearts individually, Father, as we look at your word. As we consider what you have for us to do as a church, we ask in Jesus' name, amen. We are in the midst of a series called How to Bless Your Neighbor. How to Bless Your Neighbor. We've been interrupted for a few weeks, holiday weekend, camp out and things, but we're rejoining the series because it is such an important principle for us as followers of Jesus. It's important for us to re-engage with that simple principle, blessing our neighbors. We began by looking at this foundational biblical principle. We are blessed to be a blessing. It's not about what God can do for us. It's about receiving from the Lord and then giving out to others. We are blessed to be a blessing. All the goodness that we receive from God is supposed to flow back out to others. Love your neighbor as yourselves.
that they would see how much they are loved by God. A few weeks ago, I introduced the acronym taken from the word BLESS, B-L-E-S-S, beginning with the first letter, B. Anybody remember what B stands for? Woohoo! Begin with prayer. That's what B is. We always would begin with prayer. If you want to be a blessing to someone, you begin by praying for them, because that's how we capture God's heart for someone. That's how our hearts get changed. That's how we change our perspective, by praying. By praying, because our own perspectives can become clouded. They can become warped and influenced by things that are not the Spirit of God. It all begins with prayer. We believe that God is always at work and that He wants us to join Him in His work. And this leads us to the next letter in the BLESS acronym, L, and L stands for listen. L stands for listen. Okay, just have a little bit of fun here. Have you ever found yourself singing the lyrics to your favorite song because you heard them one way and you're singing, and then, I don't know, maybe you're at a karaoke bar and here comes the lyrics across the bottom of the screen and you realize, oh my gosh, I've been singing it wrong this whole time. I've been singing it wrong. So there's a couple of famous examples of this. And let's see, one, Elton John. Elton John apparently was a big fan of 80s TV because he sings Hold Me Closer, Tony Danza. Listen to this one. Okay, song I love called Drift Away. And for the longest time, and I really own this one, Give Me the Beach Boys and Free My Soul. Go ahead. I love the Beach Boys. I listen to Endless Summer all the time. The Eagles, Desperado, singing about a cowboy, and apparently this guy has been outright offensive for so long now. Go play this one.
You've been out riding fences.
I mean, the poor guy, he's offending people left and right. And then going back a little bit farther, Creedence Clearwater, they're trying to help people find the facilities because apparently there's a bathroom on the right. Couldn't.
There's a bathroom on the right.
Okay, this even happens to worship songs. Last one, I promise. Big song a few years ago, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. You came from heaven to earth, and my friend told me this one, something about a dead hairpiece, my dead toupee. Listen to this one.
My dead toupee.
And I tell you, I led that song hundreds of times. I had, every time, had to think, okay, it's not about hairpieces. It's not about hairpieces, Lord. My debt toupee, dead toupee. Anyway. Okay, we're finished with that. Thank you. Thank you very much. You have to listen well to get the lyrics right, right? And if you want to truly bless other people, you have to listen well. Any relationship begins with listening to someone's words, someone else's words. That's how we learn about their lives. Listening and doing it well. It's one of the most overlooked and frankly, underdeveloped skills in society today. We are not good listeners in general. When we really hear and understand what someone is saying and feeling, especially when it is someone that we have been praying for, we are giving them a precious gift. We are showing a level of care and kindness that is increasingly rare these days. David Augsburger is an American author and a professor at Fuller Seminary. He wrote a book called Caring Enough to Hear and Be Heard. He writes, being heard is so close to being loved that for the average person, they are almost indistinguishable. That's a true statement. When we want to genuinely love someone, the best gift we can give them is to listen authentically. to let them see that they are not just being heard, but listened to. This is the next step in loving our neighbors and helping them know the love of God. Authentic listening stands out because we live in a world where people just don't really listen to each other. They just don't. Most people are more interested in getting their own words out, getting their own opinions out there. I mean, look at social media for a nanosecond, and you see what I'm talking about. It's about getting your opinion out there. I mean, do you rarely see a post, "Help me understand where you're coming from by what you've written there"? No, it's like, "Oh yeah, well, this is what I think about that, and this is what I think about you." More often, it's just a statement of their own thoughts on whatever the matter is that the original post was based on. Someone once said, "The opposite of listening is not speaking, it's waiting to speak." It's waiting to speak. Have you ever found yourself doing this, where you're listening to someone, you're in front of them, but the whole time your mind is cranking on what you're going to say next, right? While they're speaking, you're not listening to their words. You're waiting for your chance to sling your opinion out there. I've done this lots of times, trying to think of something pastoral to say next. You know, if someone has said, I need some help with this, and they're talking, and I'm already thinking about, Lord, what Bible verse can I, you know, eloquently deliver in this next moment? That, and then it's like, wait a minute, shut up and listen. Listen to the person standing in front of you. Right. Thank you, Lord. I bet you've been on the other side of that situation also. On the other side of it, where you just know that the other person really is not listening to what you're saying. You get a bunch of grunts, maybe the occasional, You know, maybe it's, We all know what it's like to be unheard. And when people begin to feel unheard, they begin to feel unknown. But when we are listened to, when we are seen, when we feel cared for, when we feel that we matter to the other person, this is what happens when we feel blessed. This is what we can do for our neighbors, for other people. And listening well doesn't mean we launch into fix-it mode. Anybody else know fix-it mode? Fix-it mode. I wish I had a dollar for every time I went into fix-it mode with my wonderful wife, where she came and wanted to tell me about something. And I'm immediately, I'm like getting in my mind, okay, I get my checklist out, let's fix this problem. All right, let's go after it. What's our next step here? Thankfully, I've grown and matured, and now, of course, I'm a master at listening to my wife. Whatever she brings to me, just ask me. I'm a master at listening to her. In reality, there have been more than a few times where she let me know that she's not asking me to fix her. She's not asking me to fix a problem. She wants to be heard. She wants to be listened to. She wants to feel my support and my care. She wants to know that I care enough to shut off all the background noise, to turn off the phone, and give her my undivided attention. It's not an easy thing to do, is it? I mean, in the world of multitasking, in the world of getting as much done as possible with every moment of every day, we're so used to thinking ahead, thinking about the next thing, that it's a challenge to just come back and rest in the present moment. But this is what listening is all about. When people in our lives feel heard and known, they feel loved. They feel loved. And of course, the opposite is true also. If we want to love our neighbors well and bless the people that God brings us into contact with, we must become purposeful about listening and doing it to gain understanding. And my friends, Jesus was a great listener. He was an amazing listener. And if there's anybody who didn't have to be, it was Jesus. He could have had a continuous stream, and everything he said would have been good and worthy to listen to. He didn't have to stop and listen to anybody, but he did. He did. So many times, Jesus stops and slows down to listen to people. He models listening for us through so many different stories in the gospel. And his listening was always motivated by love and by looking for what the Father was doing. Let's look at one example here in Luke 18, the story of the blind beggar. Beginning at verse 35. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." He called out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Lord, I want to see," he replied. Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has healed you." Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When all the people saw it, they also praised God. Just another amazing example of Jesus. Jesus was on his way to Jericho, which was one of the last stops on the way to Jerusalem, where the Passover feast was happening soon. So he had a destination. He's on the way. He's not standing in the midst of a large crowd teaching like he does so often. Though the city would have been majorly crowded because of this upcoming festival, one of the biggest festivals on the Jewish calendar. Super crowded. And in the midst of this, on the way, he hears a single blind man calling out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And it says that the people with Jesus rebuked the man, told him to be quiet, told him to shut up. "You are not the kind of person we are listening to today, and Jesus has places to be. Look, step back into your insignificance and pipe down, buddy. We're doing something important here. You're not part of it. We're on our way to something." And it's Jesus who stops when he hears the cries. And I love that he orders the man to be brought to him. I got to believe it's some of the same people who are shushing the guy. "No, go get him. Go get him. Bring him here. I want to see him." I would say they got a real lesson in kingdom principles that day. I hope it's stuck. Jesus stops, has the blind man brought to him, and asks the question, "What do you want me to do for you?" And you might think, that's a little obvious, Jesus. He's blind. It's kind of, okay, help him see. That's what we want to do here. But Jesus takes a moment to ask a question, to ask the man what he wants him to be done for him. He engages with the man. He could have just restored his sight. He literally could have, on his way, reached over, pointed, and the sight would have been restored, but he doesn't do that. He models for us listening, asking a question, stopping, pausing, and engaging. And imagine, as I'm reading this, imagine what that must have been like for this man. Living in darkness, surviving only by the kindness and the giving of other people, begging every day, can't see, being discarded, being on the absolutely on the fringe of society, and then this commotion. What's going on? It's Jesus. I've heard of Jesus. I've heard his name mentioned. He cries out, "Have mercy." And then, again, in the darkness, angry voices, "Be quiet. Don't bother the prophet. Don't bother the teacher." And at that point, in desperation, having lived on the fringes so long, "Have mercy." And then you're being led. And then people are leading you. And the next voice you hear is the voice of Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Can you imagine what that must have felt like for this blind man? That he hears the voice, and then he says, "Lord, I want to see." And the next thing that he sees is Jesus. The next thing he sees is the face of the man who heals him, the Son of God. And he walks praising God with Jesus, but he has that memory of that voice. He has the memory of that question, the moment where the darkness fled and the light broke in. Immediately before that, what do you want me to do? The Son of God engaged with him. How much more should we be engaging with the people that we want to be ministering to? Jesus stops everything to notice this man, and it creates an opportunity for God's kingdom to break into his life. Powerful time. There are so many examples of Jesus doing things like this, engaging with people living on the edge, living on the outside, the outcasts of society. Jesus doesn't reject them. And he does more than just notice them. He engages with them. He listens to them. This is who our God is. This is who our God is. As we've said so many times, one of our duties, one of our jobs as followers of Jesus is to simply present the true reflection of God's character into the world. Because the enemy is working as hard as he can to distort it, to tell people that God is something else. But God is good. God sees everybody. God sees the poor, the outcast. It's kind of like the sense of a mother has about her kids. This sense that Jesus being attuned to what God does and being attuned to his children and the outcast. I remember as our kids were small, Judith developed this sense where I'd be oblivious. I'm gone. I'm asleep. And she hears the slightest noise, and she's alert, and she's awake, and she's concerned about the kids. And it doesn't go away. I mean, they're 25 and 18, and just last night, Judith said, did you hear it at 4:30 in the morning? No, I didn't hear anything at 4:30 in the morning. What are you talking about? Oh, Jonathan was bumping around in the restroom or something like that. She still has that sense. In the midst of all the commotion of that journey, Jesus heard the blind man. And then he doesn't assume that he knows what the man wants. This is a wonderfully important lesson for us. Don't assume that you know what someone needs. It's very easy to do that. It's very easy to make assumptions on what people's needs are. Sometimes it's obvious. Yes, you can always give food. That's always a good thing. But the extra mile is engaging. Jesus asked questions and listened to the answers. We should also. This is how we can best be a blessing to our neighbors, to our friends, to our families. Ask questions and then listen well, just as Jesus did. And we have to be willing to stop what we're doing. We have to be willing to pause in the itinerary and the agenda for that to happen. To give our full attention, to be fully present to somebody. Meaning, we stop multitasking. We stop multitasking for a moment. And we silence the phone. And you maybe you even take the moment, let me turn the notifications off. And then I can listen well. I used to have a smartwatch. I couldn't handle it because it was buzzing and everything else. And I wanted to focus so much on the person in front of me. I just said, I'm just going to get another old Casio. Good old Casio. They just keep ticking, you know? But this is what we do. It means placing the person in front of you and what they're saying immediately at the top of your priority list. I mean, instantly, right now. This person is the most important thing that I can do right now in this moment. That's what it means to pause and to listen well for somebody. This is how we're going to get to know the people in our lives. Our neighbors, the neighbors around where you live, the neighbors in our neighborhood. And taking the time, getting to know people is how they will begin to feel valued and cared for and loved. And yes, Jesus healed many, and he raised people from the dead. But there are so many accounts where Jesus simply had normal interactions with people. So don't fall into the trap where if something amazing didn't happen, where somehow it was a lesser encounter. No. Jesus worked in the mundane, in the everyday. He lived in that, and he models for us that we have to do that. So much of life is just walked out in real caring, real listening, real engagement with other people. Don't miss this. Living a life that blesses others most often means participating in the regular and ordinary aspects of other people's lives. I mean, helping somebody roll their trash can, an older neighbor, helping them do something, someone drops something, helping them, just engaging in simple everyday lives, living a life of kindness and generosity. Michael Frost is a missiologist and a theologian who tells a story that illustrates this. And it's a story about a group of missionaries traveling to a remote village in India, and very poor village. But they get there, and they've been heavily resourced. I mean, they have the skills and the supplies and even the money to do something significant. I mean, they go and they say, we can build you a medical clinic to take care of the sicknesses that you're facing. We can build a school for education. We can build a church for you here. Because we're ready. We've got resources. We've got talent. And then they ask, what do you want us to do for you? And they said, what we really need is a mailbox. But we can build a medical clinic. What we really need is a mailbox. Okay. Turns out that a mailbox gets you a zip code. And in India, no zip code means no recognition by the government. No recognition by the government means you're not eligible for the social services and the other things that the government will bring to you. And they found out that it took about 2 years for them to get that mailbox and that zip code for that village. And when they did that, transformation started to happen in the village. They didn't need another building. They needed a mailbox. They needed recognition. And so they listened and they put aside their idea of what they needed and they listened to what it was. When you take the time to listen, you'll discover what is really going on in someone's life. Now, I had a little picture of this a couple of weeks ago, right before the campout. It was a Friday, and my friend had asked me to help him. He lives down towards Gig Harbor. I was driving north on I-5. Car starts to shake, start hearing this loud noise. And then, you know, that sinking feeling where all of a sudden the car kind of droops on one side. And here comes my entire tire tread rolling in front of the car and bumping into the median. Not the tire tread, like the whole. And I need to get over. So I get over, I'm on I-5. I get over, this is right before the interchange with Highway 18. As soon as I pull over, a black car pulls over right in front of me. So I get out and look, and it was weird. The entire tread had separated, leaving just the rubber sidewalls all the way around the rim. So I was riding on rubber. The rims didn't get damaged. But this man gets out, and he's probably in his late 60s, and he comes over, hey, I saw you had a black Honda. I've got a black Acura. I figured my spare would fit on your spare if your spare didn't work. And it turns out my spare was fine. I hadn't looked at my spare since we have owned the car, I think, but my spare was fine. But turns out he was a mechanic. Turns out that he had, you know, something that would help get the... He started taking lug nuts off. He just went to town. And we started talking, and turns out he's a builder of cars. He's been building hot rods since he was 14 and this and that. And I said, okay, well, I've got this spare. What should I do? Well, you're not supposed to drive. Don't drive on the freeway on this thing. This is supposed to get you to a tire store. I know a tire store. I live pretty close. Why don't you just follow me over there? Okay. Now, I follow him over there, and you realize that in our society now, suspicion is woven into most everything that we do. We're suspicious of anybody else that we don't know. This could turn into a disaster. This could turn into something horrific. And so I'm trying to listen. Father, are you doing something here? Are you, what's going on here? He says, follow me. I follow him because I didn't have a check in my spirit. We get to the tire store and they have the tire. It's going to take an hour and a half. The guy says, would you like to come over to my house for a second? Okay, next step. Okay. Yeah, I got time. And so we go over there and he just starts talking. And he has seven cars like in his garage and in the front. He's got a stack of pallets. I mean, he obviously lives by himself and he loves cars. And I know enough about cars to get engaged with that. And I just kept asking him questions. Pretty soon he said, wait a minute, hold on a second. I'll meet you in the front of the garage. So I, pick my way through the piles of stuff. He opens the garage. There's three custom hot rod motorcycles. There's a trike here. There's a restoration project. And here's this like 50-something Chevy. And he just starts showing me this stuff. And he's a welder and a fabricator. He shows me this. And I'm loving it. And then pretty soon, eventually the car dealership or the tire place, the tire's ready, takes me back over there. And he would not take any money from me. I tried. I said, nope. In fact, this happened back on the freeway. Nope, I believe that the good Lord wants us to do good for people. You just pay it forward. Okay, he's got... So he takes me back, and I reach for my wallet and says, I'm not going to give you any money, but I just wanted to give you my card. And it's the first time I told him that I'm a pastor. And he says, oh my gosh, if you're a pastor... He said, do you want to come over and have a beer? He said, if I'd known you're a pastor, I wouldn't have offered you a beer. And I said, that's okay, don't worry about it. That's fine, no worries. But I said, he told me about he's having pain in his legs. He had been divorced. He had a rough relationship with his sons. I said, can I pray for you? And I just prayed for his leg, and I prayed for him. And he said, this has been the best day I've had in years. I mean... And all we did, and I, okay, there was no healing of his leg, okay? His leg wasn't healed. Pain didn't go away. But it was such a picture to me, okay. I had a camp out to go to. I was supposed to get home, and we were going to pack so we could get to the camp out on Friday night. Okay, Lord, help me. I'm going to put this guy at the top of my agenda and just be present. And oh, believe me, he did most of the talking. Absolutely. And at the end of it, he says, this has been one of the best days I've had for a long time. Okay, thank you, Father. Just a normal, everyday interaction where, okay, instead of being fearful that, let's be honest, you got to be wise. You got to be wise, okay? Innocent as doves, wise as serpents. So I'm checking, okay, Father, are you in this? And I didn't have a big caution rise up in my spirit. I want to listen to the spirit, not to, headlines. And it turns out to be this great interaction, just everyday stuff. And it's just become a picture for me. And he let me take a picture of him. I was going to put it up on the screen, but I forgot. Because this engine was amazing. I mean, this custom engine. I said, let me take a picture with the engine. And I just feel like once in a while, I'm just going to reach out to him and say, hey, man, how you doing? I was thinking about you. Just praying for you. I mean, he said, you pulled the tire off. Okay, your brakes, you need new brake pads. I know a guy. Just give me a call. We'll come over and we'll pull the car in the yard and we'll just get the brake pads fixed. I just might do that. It just turned into a great interaction. When was the last time that you slowed down long enough to ask your neighbor how they're doing? To ask a coworker how they're doing, to ask a single mom that you know, are you hanging in there? Are you doing okay? When was the last time you stopped to give your full attention to someone that the Lord brought to mind? Ask a question, then listen to their heart. Don't try to understand without first listening. In fact, a great verse, Proverbs 18:13, to answer before listening, that is folly and shame. Boom! Go Proverbs, To answer before listening is folly and shame. Listen to understand the other better, their hopes, their hurts, their dreams, their disappointments. their longings. The big question is, are we willing to listen? Because it takes time. It takes time. It means allowing for the interruption. It means adjusting your priority list for the day. But you never know when it's going to turn into, I so needed this today. I so needed somebody to pay attention to me today. Truly listen to the people around us, the people we're praying for. We can not only listen to the people around us, we can listen to the places around us. Because places can have a heartbeat also. Acts chapter 17, Paul is in the city of Athens, and the city is full of idols. Full of idols. The text says that Paul was distressed by the idols that he saw, and he went to the synagogues to reason with the Jews and with the Greeks who feared God. This was a city of people who loved to talk about ideas with each other. In verse 21, it says, all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul took time to understand the people of the city and to listen to who they were. And eventually they asked him to speak to them. They were curious about these new ideas he was bringing. Verse 22, Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The Athenians were seekers of knowledge, so Paul, after listening to them, getting a feel for the city, sets out to tell them about a God that they could know in a way that they'd never experienced before. Paul listened, he observed, and when given a chance to speak, he was ready. We know that Paul was the kind of man who would do anything to reach a people group. That's who he was. I will be anything. I'll become everything to every man for the sake of the gospel. That's who Paul was. And at Athens, he knew what to do because he listened well. Listening is one of the most practical ways that we can bless our neighbors. Dallas Willard, one of my favorite authors, and he wrote, the first act of love is always the giving of attention. So simple, so true. The first act of love is always the giving of attention. God is at work everywhere we go. In the places we live, the places we work, the places that we play. And he wants people to know that they are loved. If we are able to be mindful of that and to keep listening, we are going to be ready when he says, tag, you're up, the nudge. Stop for a second. Why don't you engage with this man? Why don't you go to his house and spend an hour with him? Jesus listened to one man's voice in a crowd. The Apostle Paul listened for the heartbeat of a city that he loved, that he wanted to bring the love of God to with the gospel. But he had to slow down to do it. Jesus had to slow down to do it. He paused in his journey for the sake of that one man. Every day we're going to come across people that God loves. Every day. They might intimidate us. They might make us feel uncomfortable. We might not know what to do. But if we would be a people that listen well, that would be willing to engage, we're going to see God do some stuff. We're going to see the love of God flow out to people. And I just want to be clear. We ask, and we listen, we are people of the Spirit of God. We have said this over and over. It's posted on our wall. We are people of the kingdom who partner with the Holy Spirit in reconciling people to God. And that reconciliation can begin with a simple conversation. It can begin with asking questions and listening well, and that person feels heard. And we also listen to the Holy Spirit. Okay, Father, what are you doing? What are you doing? And we are going to continue to pray, Father, may we see your kingdom break in. Not only will we be kind and show love, but may we see the power of your kingdom come in. knowing that it's all about Him. It's not about us. It's about Him showing love to somebody that they might know that they are loved and be set free from whatever is binding them, whatever is troubling them. That's what it's about. Amen. Would you stand with me, please? Holy Spirit, we invite you now to come and fall in this place as we pause to listen well to you. I felt like the first thing that I want to ask is that the Holy Spirit would show you those people who He is inviting you to pray for. We passed out cards a few weeks ago so that you could write down people's names, four or five people, stick it on your fridge, put it on your computer screen, wherever, so that you would be praying for God to bless them. I'm going to ask God to show that to you again right now. Father, by your Spirit, show us those people that you are inviting us to pray for, to pray your blessing on. Yes, Lord. Bring to mind names, faces. Now I encourage you, write it down, record it, make a note on your phone. Do what you have to do to remember those people. Don't forget what God has shown you right now. We've asked Him. He's shown you. Now, let's be intentional about praying for those people. However you best do it, whatever system you use, let's be intentional about asking God to bless those people that He's shown us, while at the same time praying, God, use me as an instrument of your blessing. Thank you, Father.
One of the exercises that were taught me, about 5 years ago, is paying attention to God on the ordinary and mundane, and not just for myself and listening to Him, but listening to Him as I interact with people, whether it's on the internet, on Zoom, or even, at the grocery store and things like that. So one of the things I have written down as a daily prayer is, Lord, help me pay attention to what you're doing today. Help me pay attention as I'm doing my errands. Help me pay attention as I'm having conversations, to listen well, to hear what your Spirit is doing, and also to take action when you're inviting me to do that. So if you remember, and I'm going to pray, Lord, that you would help us to pay attention, to pay attention, God.
Thank you, Father.
That we're not waiting for that big transaction, Lord, but paying attention for this, the little acts of kindness, Lord, whether it's saying thank you to a barista or asking them about something, Lord, or interactions with someone might bump in the street and we would not normally have a conversation, paying attention to our fellow employee who might irritate us, God. May give us a chance, Lord, to see what's behind what's going on, Lord. To pay attention, Lord, to our loved ones when they're not able to articulate, Lord, what's going on. Help us pay attention to you and what you're doing, Lord.
Yes, God.
And help us not be afraid, Lord, but listen to the promptings and the urges of the Holy Spirit to love your neighbor.
Yes, God.
To love your neighbor, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
We can't do it without you, Lord. So I ask in the name of Jesus. I'm going to invite us to open our hands and ask in the name of Jesus to empower us with the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Father.
Empower us with the Holy Spirit to love one another well.
Thank you, Father.
To bless people.
Thank you, Lord.
And when there's an opportunity to pray with people, thank you, God, for your invitation. We say yes to you.
Yes.
With no fear.
Yes, Lord.
But with anticipation of what you're going to do when we say yes. The burden is not on us, Lord.
Yes, God.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We're going to close our service. If you need prayer for anything today, we invite you to come up. We'll pray for you. Turn to someone next to you and get prayer. But now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. May the God of hope fill your heart with all joy and security as you trust in him, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, your heart would overflow with hope. Father, may your kingdom come and your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Make us a people who listen, who pay attention, that we might bless our neighbors, Father. In Jesus' name we pray all these things. Amen. Amen. If you need prayer, please come on up. Have a wonderful week. We'll continue talking more about blessing our neighbors next week. God bless you.